Yeah, we're, yeah, whoever you ask will come up here and answer the questions. But we just, we're kind of sitting over there so everybody can see who to direct their question to. Okay. All right, we're about to begin our question and answer panel with all of our speakers. So just take turns coming up to the microphone here and make sure to direct your question towards a particular person, or if it's not towards a particular person, just say, well, hello. Just say that. So, okay then. Okay, we got visitors that want to speak as well, I guess. Okay. All right. Okay. Here we go.
Okay, I'll go ahead.
Calling all Macs. All Macs.
Okay, I'm sorry to be so temperamental, but the laws of physics do apply here. You have to have the cameras unpaused and rolling before you start speaking. So we're now ready. The drill is the audience can go to that microphone, ask whomever you want a question, and the speaker will come around here and use this microphone. That's just the way all the cameras are focused from the start. So that's the drill.
Thank you, Max.
Good afternoon. I don't have a particular person that this question is directed to, so whichever one of you feels that you would like to answer it, I'd be very happy. As an ambassador, and your interpretation as an ambassador, what do you feel that our position, our job, our creativity will go forth in being? How do you see the future ambassador? What do you see the role of an ambassador being? I thank you beforehand for your answer.
Okay. I feel that the best way to be an ambassador is to be an example through your heart center, to show unconditional love and compassion, to be non-judgmental, and to see everyone as a part of the whole. Everyone is plays just an important role as the other, and all of us have unique talents and gifts that we can contribute to whatever it is. So the best advice that I could give is to follow your heart. Whatever that dream is, whatever your creative avenue is, whether it be art or singing or dance or writing or whatever it is, follow your heart and just keep at it. And that's the best way to be an ambassador, is to be true to yourself. Is that a good answer?
Yes.
Okay.
This is a question for our Australian friends. I was just curious about any physical differences between the Yowies down under and what the drawings I've seen, I guess, up here in the Pacific Northwest or the other parts of the country.
There's one big difference they have, different to the Sasquatch's feet. They have the thumb toe. So, yeah, that's one difference. And there's a lot of similar things, but a bit like how people are different over the world, it's slightly different as well.
Howdy. The other thing is with the Yowie, we have lots of smaller ones. So we have them very small, and they're apparently called the tricksters or the net-nets. But there's another word, and I can't for the life of me think what it is. But they're just exactly like a large Sasquatch or a large Yowie, but they're in a miniature form, almost like a, just a small version of it. But extremely fast. My sister's witnessed one. She was out camping in Western Australia, out with Aboriginals on a river, and for the life of me, I can't think of the name of it. And there was about a half a dozen. There was a film crew and some Aboriginal people, and they were out at a sacred site. And what happened was she woke up during the night, because she felt something and looked around, and she thought she was seeing a bird running around really fast around the camp. And over in Australia, we have a bird called a bustard. And and one of the film crew, he's a sound recordist, also woke up, and he's seen this little hairy man or little being running around the camp, but extremely fast, really, you know. And he could see that it was a little hairy man. And then in the morning, they all woke up and they were having breakfast, and the sound recordist asked the Aboriginals, do you have little hairy men here? And straight away they said, oh yeah, that's so-and-so, and for the life of me, I can't think of the name of it. But they call them the tricksters, and it's quite common for them to come into your camp and steal your food. And what they did is they ran up to my sister's swag, and they actually lifted the lid up and looked at my sister. And this guy, the sound recorder, he just watched it, and he was just blown away by what he'd seen. But there's all different types. And there's also Yowies in northern Australia, and they're called the Quinkan, and they're 21 feet tall. So they range from all different sizes. And Lee and myself and Brooke, we've had interaction with them, and we've never had anything bad, but they're fine. But the Aboriginals are fairly scared of the Yowie to a degree. I don't know, there's a bit of mistrust or something, and that's their take on the whole thing. We've never had any problems, so we find them fine. And they range in all different colours, black, Brooks, he's with grey, there's apparently white, and the whole range is the same as a Sasquatch here in United States and Canada. But they seem to be, and I don't want to sound disrespectful, they seem a little bit more primitive in Australia compared to the Sasquatch and the Bigfoot here. And I don't want to be disrespectful, but I think they're not quite as evolved. But again, there's all different types of human beings at different levels of education and or development in life. So it's probably what it all boils down to.
Okay, hello. So I was asking Garrett about this earlier, and by the way, I'm cool with it now. It feels great. But so I had a experience last night, the same one that she talked about, and this morning I feel like way more telepathic and open and everything like that, and I'm able to hear them now. And so I was just wondering if you guys had any advice on ways to deal with this in like the big city or the real world or stuff like that, whoever feels like sharing any good things that you've experienced.
Uh,
All right, we addressed this in our Telepathy 101 workshop, and we're doing it again at 5 o'clock today if you're interested and still going to be around. Long story short is, how do you handle this when you go back home into the real world? And that's a really big question and an important one, because here, all of us talk to each other as equals. We're unafraid to say, this was my really weird experience, and have heads nod in understanding and acceptance and respect about what you're telling them and belief. But when you go back home, unless you're really, really, really lucky, you probably don't have this kind of a support system. And in order to grow from the aha moment, the eureka moment, the bolt from the blue that's woke you up, in order to process that, and this weekend, by the way, might take you a year. Don't expect it to all come at once. Take it at your own pace. You still have to have one foot in the physical world and pay your bills and do your laundry, but you also have to have the other foot . You guys got to back up a little bit. You're affecting the electronics again. You've got to have the other foot in that balance of, but I want to keep connected, I want to keep growing, I want to keep learning. Okay, so one, make friends here, call each other, share with each other, keep talking. You can't walk this road completely alone. You need the emotional support yourself, even for those of you who feel as if you have taken on the mantle of messenger. You still need your buddies to support you. At some point in time, once you really get practice with this, and I'd plan on going home and working with it about 30 minutes a day, just to keep your hand in it, just to know, okay, I spent my connected time. But keeping a balance physically, emotionally, and spiritually is like sitting on a three-legged stool, guys. If any one of the legs of that stool is short, you're going to end up tipped over on the ground. You got to find that triad, that balance of physical, emotional, and spiritual. Walk in this new landscape of connectedness and awareness that you're walking now. So everything you do, just kind of keep in mind, all right, what do I need to do to stay in that balance? Foot in the physical world, foot in the spiritual world today. And just take it a step at a time. Expect the overwhelm. At some point it's going to come. At some point, your brain is going to feel like jello. It just is. And you're going to go, but it's so much. Yeah, it is. We've all been there. Let your emotions surface. Pick up the phone. Call your paranormal Sasquatch telepathic buddy and say, this really weird thing happened to me today. Do you have a second? Okay? And talk it out. Don't get it stuck in your body. These are your people, guys. Make really good friends.
So I can definitely speak on this one. I lived in the heart of New York City for 36 years, actually even more than that. And it's very hard to integrate those energies, and that's layers and layers. Small towns are a little bit easier. Now I'm in the middle of nowhere, and now I want to be somewhere. I want to be with people, you know, in and out. And so, to address what you were talking about, I was with him when we did this event, for lack of a better word, this experience. And what happened was those are star people that came, and the pressure that you were feeling, if you felt any, I felt it, was very strong. Your ears start to ring, the top of your head. I mean, it was, I can handle a lot of these high energies, but it was a lot for me. And they say it's because these star people are from such a high dimension, they carry such a high, clean frequency that when they come back on this earth, it's really hard for them to be here. But our bodies are still really fairly contaminated, no matter what you do. And this, you feel that vibration. So you have to calibrate it, just like Sue was saying, is go out on the land, put your feet on the ground, and that kind of thing. All the clicks and the sounds that we heard were another language. They were talking to each other, but they were also activating us, right? And then we felt like we moved in a different dimensional existence. We went up to a ship, we were flying around, they took us on all these planetary systems. So your consciousness may feel like you're here, but you're starting to split these experiences. They're taking aspects of you in these places. And this is what's happening, is these energies are gonna come more and more, because they're coming, they're around, and they're making themselves known. So the most important thing is to find this balance. You're gonna feel this whoosh when these Sasquatch come in. It's strong. Now, how many of you feel this vibration when they're around? It's intense in your body. Your body starts to buzz. So you have to manage it. You got to calibrate it. Take a moment. Take a step back. If it's too much, these star people do not understand physicality. They were coming to me, you know, pummeling me with this stuff. And I said, I have to slow down. I have to take a break. Give me an hour lunch. I come back in 2 weeks. You regulate that, just like a psychic walking through, you know, the room of spirits. They have to say, excuse me, I'm off duty. You have to. But the best thing you can do is go on the earth and ground. Exactly like Sue said, call each other. We are our consulting teams. We're our support system. Because we'll know, and the other person will go, you're fine. You're okay. It's okay. Wow, that was really strange. Well, listen to what happened to me. And when you start to exchange those stories, which is really why we're together, this is what we're doing right now, is exchanging information and stories and stuff and feeling safe, but it's much more than that. We're helping each other understand. Everybody you tell your story to, they have a story, you know, so it becomes more normal. But this is gonna happen more and more and faster and faster. The difference is we're getting the prequel. You know, we're doing this. They're allowing us to learn how to integrate this with our body. This is gonna happen for everybody in the world. And it's going to be hard. They're going to melt down. They will. It will just happen. So be ready to see that. You're seeing it now. People are getting sick and et cetera. It's hard to integrate all this stuff. But what you need to do is just move the energy around. Meditate, breathe, drink lots of water, whatever you need to do. So for those people that are going out into the world, carry these moments and this feeling with you that you have right at this moment. We're talking about this love vibration. If you need to, ask your guides to protect you. Put a bubble around you. Do whatever you need to do. Pull in the dragons, pull in the Sasquatch. Just create these energies around you that are safe. Carry this vibration out there, because that's our job. And come back to these gatherings next year. Anytime you can find like-minded souls, we're helping each other keep each other sane. Okay? And also going into the 3D world, you are exactly where you're supposed to be. If you're in a cubicle, which I was, in the middle of Manhattan, that's where you're supposed to be. When it's your time, you'll get a message, I need to move here or move here. It's not just about being on the land. The strongest people hold that vibration. You can be that person in that space by not tuning into 3D. You do your job, you do administrative, pay your bills, talk to your kids, da-da-da, but you keep this part of yourself intact. And when you forget, just like Sue said, you call friends. And that's what this friendship is for. That's why we're all doing this together, so we help each other remember. That world is temporary. It's gonna change quickly. So take this out in that world and make that world this world. Carry it out there and live that way. The way you're living, they will start. You will find friends in the middle of nowhere, in the middle of Manhattan, that are exactly like you. You call them into being. Okay, we call each other. My brothers, my friends, my sisters, mother, father. It's okay, you know. We're all here, we're all doing this together, and never feel alone. Because look at all of us, we're doing it. So, thank you.
Well, you know, like Sue Walker said, back up because you're affecting the electronics. And I wanted to ask you experiencers, what kinds of electronics problems have you had? This to me, this setup that I have, I always really like to overcomplicate things, but I really want to convey this message to the world. And I have experienced no end of setting changes in the sound system, in the video cameras. I mean, it's enough to drive you up a wall. And then when everybody wants to reinvent the wheel and move all the cameras and microphones around, I get a little crabby. But this is really a primitive way to communicate what we're trying to communicate. Why can't we be just like a Sasquatch and plant a picture in someone else's mind like they do to us? No, we gotta have all this equipment, at least I do, to do it right in my mind. And I really wanna do it right, but what sorts of problems? Lee was about to get up, so I'm...
Well, both Mick and myself can't wear watches. They just don't work. And that's just one thing. A lot of the times, the electronic frequency of things in the house, like TVs, the kettle, sometimes... our kettle will just switch on and, you know, the TV will just come on by itself and things like that, and we just say, oh, hello, got some company. But also things will go out to take some photographs and, you know, your battery's fully charged and you'll go to start clicking and then it's just dead and the energy is completely drained that battery, only to go back in their car and come home and it's fully charged again. And this has probably happened to every one of you guys. And it's just because everything's energy, so it's like mechanical interference. That's as best as I can explain it. Does anyone wish to elaborate? Thank you.
Excuse me. It's quite funny. Around about a year after I had my encounter with my little ET friend, I started to develop what I call my interesting powers. And one of the things was whenever I drove under street lights, they would either go on or go off. And I had that... For about a year, it just went on and on and on. And then I started to play games. My daughter, Cassie, she used to dance, and I used to take her, I think it was every Wednesday night, to dancing lessons. And, you know, she did ballet and jazz and all the stuff girls do. And me and Cass, when she was only about 13, we used to play games. So I'd go up and pick her up at night, you know, and she'd jump in the car and I'd say, oh, I had to go, Cass, at your dance. And, yeah, good, Dad, you know, I did this and did that, you know. And she'd say, okay, Dad, I want some magical tricks tonight. And it was bizarre. We'd be driving home. And I'm going to be honest, I'd just drive along and I'd put my knee on the steering wheel and I'd just rub my hands together. And as we come under a light, I'd just go like that and bang, it'd go out or it sort of come on. And it happened time after time after time. I told some friends about this up at Katoomba and they said, oh, come on, Mick, show us. So it was me and Lee and there's a few other people that we were at a paranormal event. It was all, you know, to do with UFOs and extraterrestrials. And anyway, we were going out to a restaurant and I walked up to this pole and I grabbed hold of the pole and I said, okay, I'll see if it works. So I'm rubbing the pole and then I just went and out it went. And it, for some reason, it's my left hand. I don't know what it is. I've just got the power in the left hand. I can try my right, nothing happens. This one just reacts. And It doesn't do it as often as it used to, but it's amazing. And I don't know, it's weird. And then, you know, when we talk about phones and batteries, I remember just as an example, I went out to the Bunyip State Forest, and the Bunyip is an Aboriginal name for a doolagal or a yowie. And there's a picture out there of a doolagal, and it looks like a hyena. It's a funny looking thing, and it's not how a yowie, well, the way I think of a yowie looks like, but then again, a bunyip might be different. And I'll never forget, I was out there with Rachel and Rod, friends of ours, that are friends with Brooke and Naomi. And I wanted to take a photograph of this bunyip, you know, and my camera just would not work. I pushed it and I mucked around, I turned it on and off half a dozen times, and just wouldn't work. And yet when I went about a kilometre down the road, click, 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 just worked perfectly. So either they were messing with me or I don't know what was going on there, but it was just, yeah, it's very interesting paranormal stuff. It's just amazing and it's good fun. And me and my daughter, we used to high-five one another, you know, when I'd do a light, yeah, you know, it's just a party trick.
You know, it's really amazing how this conference reminds me, anyway, of things that I had forgotten, like the streetlight thing. Back in the 80s, when I was a bush pilot in Alaska, I'd come into town in Anchorage, and there's this really beautiful parkway, Lake Otis Parkway, with these streetlights, and it's curving. And I could go along Lake Otis Parkway, and those streetlights would go out, and I could look in my rearview mirror. Pretty soon, Lake Otis Parkway is dark. Or it would be vice versa. They'd start coming on. I'd forgotten all about that. I'm sure we've all had experiences like that. So anyway, I'll open it up for someone else.
Well, every defined energy in the universe is an electromagnetic field. What we see as matter is organized electromagnetic field. If we could raise our vibration a little higher, we could go right through. And so it's the same with the information. It's some messages, electromagnetic messages, that are sent on waves. And everything in the universe exists in that state until it is manifested through consciousness. So the electronic age, which is a new phenomenon for us, helps us also to get in touch with this reality. Most people, I think, can test that. If you have a flimsy reception, for instance, on a radio or on the Wi-Fi or something. For instance, you want to catch Wi-Fi and you don't have a very good reception. You can move around and find where the reception is good. In the same way, if you use your body or your hands, you can either act as a screen to cut the reception or as an antenna to improve it. So to answer your question, from what I've witnessed, the Sasquatch can, or the ETs with their strong energy, magnetic field they carry, either just in their bodies or through technologies, they can alter the electromagnetic fields. And that's why they will only allow us to, for instance, to take pictures they want to. That's why also sometimes they show up on pictures and we don't see them with our naked eyes because they are at a different frequency. That's why also sometimes we will see an outline instead of a full materialized shape, because they are in a higher frequency beyond the speed of light. And what happens is instead of reflecting light, they refract it. the light goes around them, so you can see an outline, and very often the background, like the trees or something, blend into their outline. So I've seen, there's too many stories to tell, but I've seen them, there's people who had Sasquatch or beings that appear in their camera, even without using their camera. They take it and there's pictures taken. There's also, I've seen them do amazing things about computer files. They can't even change government computer files. They can, we had stories where they modify a file that we post. I remember once I posted a video that Kelly shared, and when she shared it, the picture showing was from another video that she had used just the soundtrack. So those kinds of things are like not possible logically, but they do happen. And there are like little tips they give us to help understand the nature of things. Another example is when I first got my van that I bought from Mac and drove it home at Susan's and took a picture of that van. And when I looked at the photo, I saw the Sasquatch, was Camus, was looking inside the van. I said, wow. So I'm all excited and I go on Facebook and post it. And I look again and he's sitting inside the van. So I said, is my mind playing tricks or something? And so Kelly sees that photo and she sees Camus looking inside the van. And she calls Kiwani, she said, hey, come to check this out. And he looked at it and he said, no, he's sitting inside the van. So that is to, he explained to me in the last book that they keep control over what they show of themselves, even on electronic files. And they can modify it at will, because we are limited to a linear time. While if you vibrate faster than light, you're not. So they can do time loops. And they can come back and modify a file so there can be two parallel timelines.
I really felt the need to share this, or they wanted me to tell you. So for many years I worked, I'm a web producer on the internet, and things were starting to happen on and off, and all of a sudden when they start, people started visiting me, everything happened, everything started frying, and websites would crash, and my email would crash, and then files would change, and then words would rewrite themselves on web pages, and I thought, maybe this isn't the profession for me with this other kind of stuff going on. And one of the things they say is, the technology that we've evolved into so far, this is really ancient. They said the things that you see in movies right now, they've been using for 15 years in the world. So all the holographic stuff, all the crazy sci-fi things, they're in existence and people are using those things. That's where we're really behind in what we see. They said the internet is a way that, it's a system that they're using right now for negative and positive purposes, but the people that are using it in positive ways, it's actually a precursor to helping us with telepathy. So I can pick up my smartphone or the internet and I can speak to somebody in another country, you know, I don't know, 9 hours difference, time difference. So we're warping time. So we're starting to have these experiences of things that we couldn't do in real time before. I can order food online and have it delivered. I can, you know, so these, it's less about modern living and what technology is doing to us. It's more about these systems helping us evolve, because what will happen, we get one good solar flare, everything's down. And that will happen, and that will happen very soon. So this is where we have to start working with our telepathy. You know, Mary Alice, how's it going with, you know, we're doing it already, but we have to heighten these skills, because this is what will help us find each other again, the calling. So this is what the Sasquatch are actually training us to do. This is part of what happened yesterday. They're helping us raise these vibrations of consciousness. So everybody has been touched by this. Everybody, they're working with everyone in different ways. You may not feel anything or whatever, but our bodies are electromagnetic, and as the Earth evolves quickly, the vibration or the Schumann resonance of the Earth is going faster, which affects our bodies. So these are these explosions of things that happen. I put lights out, I put 3 cars out, you know, I'm getting better at honing it. So part of what I was mentioning to you is like really rebalancing this energy. You got to know when to push it out. Just like they were saying, you know, use it as a device or as an energy thing from your hands. You know, be careful not to point. I was told not to point because there's energy that comes out of my hands that could really harm people. You know, we all do this. We don't know how much power when you're projecting your energy form, your thought form right now. We think, oh, we're thinking these thoughts. Or, oh, I like this person. Oh, this person's really crazy. They hear that. They'll start to hear that. And it will affect your relationship. It will affect the vibration. Every thought and feeling and body language, I go like this. I'm pushing energy out of my arm. So be careful what you do. But they say, especially with this technology, be very aware that, yes, there are very dark energies that are using this to break down our body systems. But don't worry about it. Just put a bubble around you. You know, they have tools and technology and stones, a lot of stuff over here, I'm sure, to balance that out. But they're telling me, the Sasquatch and the Star People are saying, you already carry this in you. So if you're feeling an energy form, I mean a cell tower you go by or your computer, I hold my cell phone now and I can feel the burn in my arm. I can feel it. I can watch it move and I can feel it in my tingle. I can't even touch it almost. This is what I work with. These are my tools. So I have to push my energy in without blowing it apart, you know? So we're going to start to do this. But these are precursors of what's happening in our body right now. We have so much energy. So you have to calibrate it like that. But all of these technology systems are going away. And this is this Archon technology, for those of you who don't know what those are. There's very negative star beings. There's a couple of them that are really, they've evolved into technology and lost their heart. They've just lost a connection to their heart. This is what all the AI is about, all this advanced technology is to getting us, you know, computer chips. I mean, it's all happening, you know, chipped in your arm and, you know, implants and all this stuff. It's technology that takes away the human life form, okay? So just don't let it happen, or don't let it in your auric field. Just put a bubble around you, and you control how much or how little this affects you. But all this stuff has a purpose for our evolution, and this is what we're evolving into. We are becoming these technology devices. You're an instrument. You're a device. So, you know, use yourself wisely. Thank you.
Just real quick, and then Dave. I wanted to know about those numbers. I didn't quite get that.
Are you sure you want to know? Who wants to know what the numbers are? You guys are all crazy. All right, I will tell you and share with you. I'm going to do it through an analogy. So these numbers were brought to us, brought to me, you know, by a dear soul sister. Her name is Shirley Bolstock. She has been utilizing these numbers, activations, because numbers are frequency. Yes, they encapture certain electromagnetic frequencies that are out in the universe that are operating here on the planet. When you look at, like, for example, the Fibonacci sequence, you have those numbers that are creating that spiral, right? So everything is mathematics. So these numbers are out in the universe creating these forms. They're creating other universes. they're creating other planets. So Shirley's job was merely to be an interpreter. So what she is doing is bringing this and utilizing these numbers as another tool. So another tool, because we are now ready for them. So these numbers and certain frequencies and certain sequences are in capturing various energies. So these activations that I have performed, you know, that specific activation for the 7-7. 7-7-7 is a resonance to the Sasquatch. So that's what both Shirley and I had came up with when I did the telepathic activation with you all. I'm sure you already started to see some prior before, right, Kelly? Seeing the 7-7 synchronizing with the energy of Sasquatch. The other thing I wanted to share with you about the numbers is each one has a different frequency. Each one is utilized in a different way. It just depends on what the intention is behind it and what they're utilized for. So you guys seen the movie The Matrix? Remember the green thing? That's the numbers. So as everybody has been indicating here, you know, on the panel and whatnot, we are in what we call reality. We are in this matrix, each of us having this experience right now, correct? So the numbers, I have a set of numbers, probably all from the fun-loving things that Sharon and I have been doing. So I have encapsulated all these variations of vibration and frequencies in this body. So have you. You're operating at a different frequency, he's operating different frequency. But yet, each of us, when we're in this room together, now there's all that greater infusion that's happening. So that's what these numbers are all about. They're helping to activate, they're helping to accelerate, because from a more rational perspective, when you hear these numbers and the sequence that they encapsulate and capture, that's what you're bringing and instilling these vibrations into your fields. Does that make sense? Okay, did I answer the question? Awesome, there you go.
This is a very urgent question, sorry. No, actually, I've been waiting a while for it. Not because of you, Max, sorry. We just had a gathering, Max and I and Laura. We were in Oregon for the eclipse. And since then, I've been integrating the experience, you know, what all me and my family and friends, you know, saw that day. You know, my personal experience was great. You know, I got my family together, we had good times, my friends, and it was a way to gather and celebrate each other as well as this incredible event. And so my question is sort of anthropological in nature. You know, the Sasquatch share our world with us. What is their take on the eclipse? How do they celebrate it, or is it something, some cause for concern, as some humans here seem to think? So anybody that feels they have an answer to that, love to hear it. Thank you. Thank you.
Does Sasquatch or do the Woodman know about the eclipse and celebrate it or pay it any attention or get scared of it? The honest answer is it depends on the developmental stage of that particular clan or nation. Okay? If you have an advanced ancient Sasquatch, they know that we're standing on a designer planet that was created specifically with a moon exactly the right size and placed in exactly the right orbit to even create eclipses. And so when the ancients see an eclipse, they're celebrating the architects, the designers, the builders of our world, and how exquisite the original design was. Okay? But the less evolved or less developed nations, like Mick described down in Australia, may not yet have the culture that understands that concept or the development. Would they note it as a 20 million year old species? A lot of them would, because they'd seen it before. But I can't say that I would automatically assume that all of them, every single clan, every single culture on every single continent, would be at a developmental stage of the same level of understanding. Does that make sense? So I guess that would be my take on the eclipse. I know that our local clans in New Mexico went and celebrated. It was not a hardship thing, but we had a lot of cloud cover, and so wasn't as big a deal as the folks that had clarity and went into total darkness and came back into the light. So, okay.
All right, I debated about asking this question over and over, and I got to thinking, well, there's probably some other people here feeling the same thing. But I'm a very passionate person when I believe something, you know, and I feel it so deeply. I've always been that way. And my passion is very strongly about the earth and the environment and what we're doing to it. And I have two children in that field as well. And we have Earth's Classroom on our property, which we've seen 60,000 kids now, teaching them about the environment. But I'm very blue in a very red state, and people all around, you know, we're making an impact, but wow, there's just so much negativity about it still. And I know what you're saying about staying positive and, you know, being the change you want to see, and I'm kind of getting from some of you that you're sort of not supposed to say anything or do anything because it's going to all be okay. But I know so many facts and statistics, and it's just hard for me to ignore it and to not say anything. So maybe I'm just a warrior inside, you know. So I want to do something, and for you, when you say don't, that's really hard for me. So could somebody, and I would like to have more than one answer. Thanks.
Okay, are you ready for the answer? Okay, so with me, what I have right now, I have a bag of crystals. So what I'm doing, in addition to helping each and every one of you, part of why we're here, helping Mama Earth, right? Raise the consciousness. So from a warrior perspective, it's not so much going out there protesting, going out there and working from the angle of the aggressive. It's about the way of the peaceful warrior now. That time has changed. It's shifted. Some of us are programmed to do those things. Some of us are not. So here's what I do. The warrior me, because I can relate, I've been galactic warrior many times, I know. But here's what I'm doing to help Mama Earth. So with these crystals, if you go on my Facebook page, NavajoIlluminations.com, I have been documenting all the ceremonies in which I am performing utilizing crystals. Crystals hold a vibration. Crystals are also amplified with our intentions. They are programmed. They're no different than we are. right? No different than a computer. So you program them. So what I've been doing is programming these crystals with higher infusions of love, of healing, but higher joyful awareness as to why we love Mama Earth so much. When you take these crystals and you put them into water, what does the water do? When you put it into moving water, what does it do? It carries these vibrations and it touches all those who drink, swim, and play within these waters. The water goes to a larger body, a pond, a stream, a lake, an ocean. When it heats up, what does water do? Evaporate. So now it's going into the clouds. Because water, as Emoto's work, carries vibration, right? So this is one way, very effective, but also very simple. So you're instilling these vibrations through the utilization of water and crystals. So you offer the crystals to the running source of water. Those vibrations and intentions that are infused in the crystals are now being infused into the water molecules. And then from that instance, they touch, like I said, they touch everything that eats, swims, drinks from the waters. They evaporate into clouds. And then what happens? It rains. It snows. So this is how the earth work that I'm performing and assisting. A few years ago, unfortunate circumstances in the Navajo Nation, there was a mine spill on the Animas River. It happened in Colorado, just north of Silverton, near Durango. This mine spill had affected the river source for us because it flows into the San Juan River, and it's the primary source for our water, for not just the Navajo people, but all people who live in the San Juan Basin. Very arid, very desert. And it so happened that I was down there, and I was at the Gathering of the Healers at the time. And of all things, you know, Spirit says, Garrett, you need to go look at your Facebook. I was like, what, really? See, this is where Spirit's using technology in a positive light, right? So they had asked me to go to my Facebook page, and the first thing that pulls up is I see that this mine spill had happened. I say, okay, now I know what to do. So I was on a mission, and I was, of course, at a gathering such as this with healers. I had placed the call out etherically. I need help. Please send me crystals. The next day, they came. Everybody who already on a subconscious level were performing these crystal ceremonies in their various workshops. And I was collecting medicines from all over, crystals from all over. I even received medicine from our Havasupai brothers and sisters of the Grand Canyon. They gave this to me because the river flows into the Colorado River and then it flows into the ocean. So right away, what I had done was I collected these crystals with the intention that I was going to utilize them healing the waters of this river. And as I journeyed back to Denver, I was told to stop at certain areas, at different placements along the San Juan River, along the Animas River, and I there was performing these crystal ceremonies and I was offering them to the waters. Since that time, I've heard that energetically, I already know that it's doing its work. We continue to do work in that vicinity because it's a big deal, right? So this is just one way, you know, one way that you can do, that you can, very simple. All you're doing is taking a quartz crystal, or no matter how big, how small it is, no matter what kind of crystal, you can take these crystals to a running source of water. And as I mentioned, I do have these crystals. They are at our booth here. And I would like to request, and I take them no matter where I go, I take them. If you are called to do this work, please pick a crystal, put your loving infusions into them, and bring them back, put them back there. And I will take them to a running source of water on our way back, especially with regards to these fires that are happening here. I will do ceremony on the way back to Denver with this. We've already done some work on the way up, but on the way back, because as a collective, the energy that is here in this space, it's a lot more magnified. So this is how, you know, one way, but very effective, that you can utilize, you know, your warrior energy in this instance, you know, to help make a difference. Because with each passing vibration, with each crystal that I'm putting into the water, I'm changing the planet. We're changing the planet together. And it's not just me. I know of others who are doing this work, and whenever I'm in a group setting like this, it's a lot more potent, so I know we're making a difference. Does that help? Awesome, thank you.
That's kind of cute, because I actually have almost a bushel of crystals that I dug up in Arkansas, and I was always trying to figure out what to do with them.
Now you know, I know. On a subconscious level, see, you were already figuring out what to do.
Yeah, thanks, Garrett. You give new meaning to the water is life catchphrase.
Yes.
And the thing that really brought out the warrior in me was this winter during Standing Rock's protests and how they used water in freezing temperatures. That just, I hit the ceiling. We have a similar fight that's been going on in Oregon for 10 years. It's raising its ugly head again, the LNG pipeline. It's proposed to go clear across Oregon, the most beautiful part, from Malin in Klamath County, clear to Coos Bay, and it's going to be a 232-mile long glyphosate-soaked scar across the land, because they have to keep it free of vegetation so that they can inspect it. You know, what do we do? The warrior in me wants, I don't know, because I was a naval aviator, I want to go, you know, I wish I had a Hawker Harrier or something, but to me, you know, oh, it's nice to have crystals and, you know, but there's got to be a happy medium. Yeah. I'd get thrown in jail if I drop napalm on the builders, but anyway.
So if you were to do it, how are you any different than the people who are doing it to begin with? So you work from the vibration of the heart in that instance. And there, I would, you work with the tools. So you utilize the tools. But what I'm hearing on this is that Mama Earth needs more appreciation, gratitude. Sometimes the reason why certain things happen like this in our certain sacred places is because we've forgotten. We've forgotten how sacred they are. We've forgotten, you know, energetically how value it is. We take it for granted. That's just the nature of who we are as humans, right? It's always like, you know, I tell individuals, why is it that you only appreciate something until it's taken away from you, you know? You could be enjoying the colors, yet you go blind and you always sit there and regret, I shoulda, coulda, woulda, right? So from that instance, from that placement, you work in the energy of gratitude. Sending that gratitude, illuminating the lands, illuminating, because Mama Earth knows. I had asked her the question because I'm very connected to her. I said, Mom, why do you put up with us? Why do you put up with this crap and the garbage that your kids are doing to you? And her response to this question was, because I love you that much, that I'm willing to put up with this. And so it brought new meaning to me, because this is awareness for us as a collective, as human individuals. As human individuals, this is how we go about illuminating, spreading the light, reminding everybody, you know, it doesn't really have to be as hard as it seems, right? This is where the serious heyoka comes in, right? So you go out, do your thing, do your work, but you do it in laughter, you do it in joy. And that's how most effective, because if you're at peace within yourself and you're connected to Mama Earth anyway, through the iron that flows in your blood, then she's going to heal herself. She has the capability to do that. She's a vessel, but she loves us that much that she's willing to take this on so that we can do something about it as far as caring for ourselves, caring for our brothers and sisters, the forests, the animals, because this is a school of learning. It is a place of learning. It is a planet of learning. And so when we do these ceremonies or when we do these offerings like that, That's how we rekindle our relationship back with her, and we hold that highest vibration, because highest vibration is always going to diffuse density. It always is. So the more we can work on ourselves and hold the highest vibration, the loving intentions that we're infusing all across the land, then some miracle will happen. It will shift, just like what happened at Standing Rock. A lot of the intentions there, you know, I was doing a lot of earth work in the background, a lot of ceremonies in the background, but those protesters and the people that were there were the forefront. But they were doing it from such a peaceful way, from a place of love. And now they're shifting the dynamic because they were on the spotlight from a global perspective. So they were sharing how we can become stronger as a collective, working from the heart, honoring and recognizing Mama Earth for who she is, and the planet and all the waters that are considered sacred. So this is one way in which you can help yourselves. Continue to be the light, continue to shine the light, do what you can to maintain it, do what you can't, you know, if you feel the call, need to do something. I mean, I carry a bag of crystals wherever I go, and I certainly make an effort to find a running water source. Very effective, very simple ceremony, but very effective. Does that help? Awesome. Thanks, guys.
Yes, I just wanted to add to that, too, that what's been advised to me through spirit when I think about, you know, the state of the world affairs and how we can change things is that we can't change the world. It's too big. If one person tried to change the world, it would turn around and destroy you. But what we can do is change ourselves, and we can change our thoughts, and then the whole world around us changes. So each and every person in this room is going through a change or going through a shift, and we're changing. And now when we gather together like this, we are creating a collective change together. So not only are we changing ourselves, but all of us just sitting here talking about this is changing the world, because we're in such a high vibration of love. And that's, you know, really what it all boils down to. We're all gonna leave here, and we're gonna carry that with us, and we're gonna affect different people that we've met. We're gonna meet new people. We're gonna be bringing in new people to our lives that are going to be able to feel this, you know, increase in energy. And that's how the world changes, is through positive thought projection. Really. And anyhow, just the more people that are awakening to this, the more people who collectively gather like this, it changes the world, even though it may not look like it from our perspective where we're sitting right now. But how many of us had fears and doubts or was worried about chemtrails this weekend? Or who really thought about the president this weekend? Nobody. We were all in this space of love and peace and compassion with each other. And so all that negativity is no longer there. So just hold on to those high vibrations and connect with others that hold on to that. And that's how we change. Yeah. You're welcome.
Okay, so as I teach a lot of people, a lot of healers, you know, then everyone comes in, they're saying, we have so much to do, we have to heal the world. Everyone feels this burdens on their shoulders. And every time I teach a class, White Buffalo Calf Woman comes to me, comes through me, and she shares a message. Just work on one person at a time, and then that person will work on another person, and so on and so on. So instead of feeling the burdens of the world, we can relax, follow our heart, and notice when you make a change, it starts with one. That's all I have to add.
I was wondering really quick if I could share some the very first thing that a Sasquatch ever told me. It was regards to this. You don't have to walk off. I was going. So I had my car running. It was on Kiwani's property, and they said, "Thank you for using biodiesel, or for not using gasoline." I was like, "Wow, that was." They really said that, and it really surprised me. But in regards to changing yourself, I drove up here with recycled vegetable oil in my car. And one way that you can make a change is, you know, if you don't like a pipeline, stop using gas yourself and find an alternate way to get around. And then if everyone does that, no more pipelines. So that's it.
So, back up. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's great. I need the exercise. We were talking about this a little bit too, and the thing you got to remember is Mother Earth is fine. She's very powerful, and she is allowing this to happen for an understanding. She can heal herself very quickly. All the elementals, the elemental beings, the fire, air, water, earth and etheric and sky and etheric beings. They're beings that are physical, and then there are beings that are these energy forms. Heal quickly and work quickly. Our body, you know, when you get a cold, you go through a cleansing process. It's part of this process. For her to go through these experiences is also part of this process for her to raise her vibration. So you look at the water right now that's happening in Houston. I know a couple people there, and I'm hearing everything in reports. I was told by this Ojibwe grandmother that she shared that that's the water elementals. We're not appreciating the water. So that's the balance. You know, when they're fracking, they're sticking holes into the earth. It's very intense, but you can't get mad at that, because those people that are doing that work, some of them are actually doing it to try to find solutions for other things. They have a good intention, they just don't know the difference. There are people behind them that are doing that to cause problems in the earth and cause problems for lots of reasons. If they distort the balance of the earth, then we're gonna be affected, which is what they want. But you can't get angry about it, because you're just feeding into that. And actually, that is sometimes, nothing is as it appears in this world. The fracking is actually opening fissures in the earth so that the gas can come out to change our electromagnetic field, to vibrate our body, to ascend. So what you see as something bad, or the judgment of bad, could be good with something behind it. We don't know these higher realms of causes and purposes. When you see this black-white war, or the political stuff that's going on, or any dialogue that causes conflict, it's about duality. Instead of getting mad at that, or taking sides, or having a position, you can do whatever you want. You can fight, you can flight, you can sit, you can yawn, you can get angry, you can punch, and you can dance. It doesn't matter. How you choose to react to that is who you are. But what happens is, what you don't see in this 3D world right now is there's things behind the things behind the things behind. These dark energies are controlling people that are controlled by people that are controlling people. There's lots of other stuff. Most of that stuff is architected to cause people to stay in fear, to cause people to be separated, to cause people to not work together. So you look at that particular pipeline that you talked about. I was present around that area, and I was watching these indigenous elders, these chiefs, handful of couple people, and they were reacting differently. One was very, not political, but very involved in speaking openly about the system, and you know, there were energies around him that he chose to react and act in that way. Because of his heritage, he came from that fighting spirit. That was the warrior side. That's how he chose. The other chief I was working with was watching from a distance, and I asked, why aren't you there? He said, just like Garrett said, I can heal from anywhere. And he said, that is actually their problem. Not that he wasn't taking responsibility, because we're all part of this, but he said the people of the land where these things happen, we're there. Even if you're transient, you're there to help that part of the land. You have that vibration at that part of the land to heal that land. So people in BC, they have to take care of those fires. The people in Houston have to take care of the water problem, because it's a manifestation in energy form, in physical form, of what's going on in those areas. But it has a purpose. It has a purpose. So I asked him about this pipeline, and he said the focus is not on oil. It's not on that kind of a blood of the earth. It's about water. It's what you're talking about, crystals. Water is crystals. Crystals are technology. Crystals are information. Water is the lifeblood of us. Everything is connected with water. So the war was about the water, and look what happened. All these tribes that were in conflict, that hadn't spoken in years, that were defending their territories for lots of good reasons. They were fighting against each other. All this stuff was happening. But they came together because a common denominator of water. It healed their relationships. So, and the other thing I was told is during that ceremony, when all that stuff was, the brouhaha was happening, inside, the inside of the inside of that circle, there were elders that were praying. All they were doing was talking to Mother Earth, 24/7, praying for the water, praying for the earth, praying for the elementals. Then there were children. They had camps of children that were dancing and laughing. They were keeping the earth alive. This happens in everything that you see and don't see. There are people that are helping that you don't see. Then they work with the elementals and the spirits and stuff. So my point is, people came to help, which was a beautiful thing. I knew people that went and brought food or whatever. You want to contribute. But what happened, a lot of that energy was people came with their own intentions and brought stuff that wasn't necessary for that moment. They started disrupting this flow. People were taking pictures. The pictures were beautiful. The white people, of which is, I'm in this form, but I'm, you know, we're all different. We've all been all these tribes. It's not about tribes or difference or race. You know, so there was a disconnect about how people felt about that. And taking pictures and documenting, it was so important to document because it got the news out. At the same time, these people were coming in without respecting, because they didn't know the protocol of what's happening. How am I needed? How do you need me? So there was this ego push, but they didn't know any better. They didn't know any different, and they were doing wonderful things. So it's really, there are people that are planting trees. That's what you do. But he's talking about crystals. This is how we work. The power behind this, when you work with these tools, energy tools, crystal tools, sky, earth, water, air, projecting your mind. When you work with these elementals, they're all connected. You can hold a tree and talk to a tree in Uganda. We're all connected. So putting a tree up, or getting mad because somebody's cutting down something, or moving things around, this is changing. This is all part of the process. And just keep in mind, what you see in 3D, there's stuff behind that that you don't understand, that has a bigger purpose. Politically, you see stuff going on. It's not this one man that we need to send this energy to. There's so much hate going to this particular energy or whatever. It's fuel for the fire. Don't put it that way. Put it in something else. So how you do it, it doesn't matter. Do something, but understand that this is part of the process. So thank you.
All right. Thank you all for the great questions. We'll go ahead and take a 20-minute break, and at 3:30, we're going to open up the mic here for all of the audience to share. So come up and share your stories or music or whatever you feel inspired to do. Just keep in mind that you will be recorded. So, yeah. And also, at 3:30, two workshops are beginning next door. connecting with your Sasquatch guides, with Gail Fowler, and wisdom and guidance from the Sasquatch people and elders with Shikara. All right. Okay. Okay. And just so you all know, we are, you know, it's still full night camping, everything like that. It's we just asking people to kind of be packed up and ready to go by like 1 p.m. tomorrow. But, you know, like I said, if you're just packed up and want to hang out a little bit longer, that's okay too. Yes. That we're going to lock this building after dinner. We'll meet back here around, well, 5-ish. I know some of our workshops kind of disrupt that, but you're welcome to take your plate of food over there. You don't have to eat in here and stuff like that. But after dinner, so I would say around 6-ish. Tonight we'll lock up this building here, but I'll be around. I got a key if anybody needs in. So, I want to sleep in a little bit. So yeah, no, probably around 8 a.m. tomorrow. Okay, sure. And Max. And Sago Naturals and More, the herbal vendor next door, they're going to be closing up around 5:30 today. And also our conference booth back here where Brady's at right now, we'll also be closing that this evening. So if there's any last minute things you want to get, go ahead and do that soon. Thank you.